नमस्कार दोस्तों, मेरा नाम है सीए हेमंत गुप्ता एंड आज मैं आप लोगों के सामने सुप्रीम कोर्ट द्वारा डिसाइडेड एक रीसेंट केस कंसर्निंग आईबीसी एंड आर्बिट्रेशन एंड कंसीलिएशन एक्ट डिस्कस करने जा रहा हूं। द टाइटल ऑफ दिस केस इज इंडस बायोटेक प्राइवेट लिमिटेड वर्सेस कोटक इंडिया वेंचर ऑफशोर्स। बट हैपेंड इन दिस केस, कोटक इंडिया वेंचर्स ऑफशोर हैड सम optionally convertible redeemable preference share invested in IBPL. So IBPL issued or wanted to issue QIPO, but some SEBI guidelines stopped them from issue of QIPO because they already had some outstanding convertible option preference share. So those needs to be either redeemed or converted to equity shares before issue of QIPO. So Kotak India Venture was approached to convert those shares, preference share into equity or either to redeem, but there a dispute arose as to conversion formula of those redeemable preference share and the matter went to NCLT. As Kotak India Venture filed an application under section IBC stating that they have an amount of debt due from corporate debtor and they are not paying it. So section 7 application is to be taken care of. So simultaneously, corporate debtor also filed an application under section 8 of Arbitration and Conciliation Act, which allows any judicial authority in front of whom any application is pending or before that is adjudicating to take the matter to arbitration, provided the both the parties have already have an arbitration mechanism or arbitration provision in place based on their mutual understanding. So in this case, there was a share subscription and shareholding agreement was already there between these party, and there was a clearly a clause providing up for arbitration before initiation of any legal proceeding. So NCLT, after considering all the facts and circumstances, decided that section 7 application is not maintainable and it allowed section 8 application filed under Arbitration and Conciliation Act. So simultaneously, a SLP was also pending before Supreme Court for Section 11 application under ANC Act, because the Kotak India Venture Offshore was a Mauritius based company and it was an international arbitration due to this fact. So application was also pending before as a SLP before Supreme Court under Section 11 of IBC 11 of Arbitration and Conciliation Act. So Supreme Court, after discussing or noting all the facts before placed before them, it discussed section 3 of IBC, particularly with respect to claim, debt, corporate debtor, financial creditor, default, and it said that section 7 application needs following, which is debt. There has to be some debt. There has to be some default. That default has to be with respect to debt owned by a financial creditor, and then there has to be corporate debtor against whom the section 7 application is being filed. This was also discussed in the light of Innovative Industry case, which had also placed these kind of parameter for section 7 application. Supreme Court also discussed that section 7 application, or for that matter section 9 application, once the default is there and threshold limit of 1 lakh earlier and now 1 crore, if that is breached, then the application will be maintainable. But having said all this, section 7 application, which is for time value of money, and section 9 application, which is for default on account of some goods and services by operational creditor, NCLT is duty bound to satisfy itself, particularly in case of section 7 application, wherein subsection 5 clearly provides that satisfaction of adjudicating authority of default of debt has to be there. Okay, so after discussing all this, one issue was crystallized, whether or not NCLT has the authority to discuss and decide section 8 application filed under Arbitration and Conciliation Act over and above section 7 application of IBC Act. So arbitration was discussed in the light of proceeding in rem or proceeding in personam. So there was a case which was discussed, which laid down four parameters. The case was Vidya Daruya and others versus Durga Trading Corporation. There were four parameters or four situations were laid down wherein it was clearly established or said that in those matter arbitration will not work. So what were those four parameters or four circumstances? Then cause of action and subject matter of dispute relates to action in rem and not right in personam. That arises from right in rem. Okay. Then cause of action and subject matter of dispute affects third party rights and have erga omnes effect requiring contractual adjudication. Okay, what is erga omnes effect? It relates to rights and obligation owned towards all, that is third party. Number three, when cause of action and subject matter of dispute relates to inalienable sovereign function or public interest function of the state. When number four, I am talking now, when subject matter of dispute or cause of action is expressly or by necessary implication is non-arbitrable. So what could be the example of these parameters? For example, criminal proceedings, some dispute divorce matters, some application with regard to restitution of conjugal rights. These are clearly not arbitrable. These are clearly a matter which relates to public policy by state and there has to be some intervention by state and adjudication by normal court of law. Similarly, IBC, insolvency matter, dissolution of companies, liquidation of companies, patent matters, trademark matters, which are represented by sovereign rights. Sovereign has complete right whether to allow or not to allow these things. So these matter also cannot be arbitrated. So after considering all this, Supreme Court said that mere filing of application under Section 7 does not create a right in rem, because Section 7 application, unless and until admitted, can still be withdrawn. There could be a compromise. The application could itself be dismissed for non-maintainability. So it's only on admission of the application the third party right is created in all the creditors of the corporate debtor, leading to erga omnes effect. Okay, so now coming to Section 8 vis-a-vis Section 7. As we all know, Section 238 of IBC is there, which states that IBC has an overriding effect over all the other laws. Okay, so while discussing Section 8 application with respect to Section 7 application of IBC, there could be three situations which was pointed out by Supreme Court. Number one, the Section 7 application has been admitted and then Section 8 application has been filed. So when then Section 7 application has been admitted, the rights are created in rem against all the person, against for all the creditors. So Section 8 application of ANC Act is simply not maintainable. Okay. And second situation, when Section 7 application is not admitted, it is rejected or dismissed. So what will happen? So it says in that case, it is open to parties to form an arbitration tribunal as per their understanding or their agreement, and then NCLT is there is no need for NCLT to give any direction for formation of any arbitration tribunal. And third situation could be when the case is yet to be admitted. Okay, so what will happen? So again, there could be one situation, Section 7 application is filed before Section 8 application, or Section 8 application is filed along with Section 7 application. So it clearly said by the Supreme Court that NCLT is duty bound to first decide Section 7 application irrespective of the fact when Section 8 application was filed before it. So again, there could be two situations, either this application is admitted and this application is not admitted. So both the scenarios have already been discussed by Supreme Court. So in all the circumstances thought about by Supreme Court, there is no case where Section 8 application filed under Arbitration Conciliation Act is to be adjudicated upon by NCLT. So this was clearly stated by Supreme Court. So even adjudicating authority, NCLT, who was in this case, they clearly said and recognized that SLP was already pending before Supreme Court. They are allowing Section 8 application, but they are not satisfied by Section 7 application. And as per their understanding, the no default has occurred, but there is a dispute which revolves around three things, which is valuation of optionally convertible redeemable preference share, right of financial creditor to redeem those preference share, and date of fixing of QIPO. Okay, so all these disputes were there, which were as per their understanding of the document placed before them, that is the shareholder agreement or share subscription agreement, were arbitrable. So they had to approach the arbitration before this. However, important point, most important point I would say, which every one of you watching this video might be thinking, that how can a preference share, which is quasi-equity of sorts, be a financial debt? However, a note was also placed in this decision. Since no party has claimed this issue, whether the preference shareholder are financial creditor or it's a financial debt or not, either before Supreme Court or before adjudicating authority, no comment or no adjudication was given by Supreme Court or adjudicating authority on this point. However, this remains to be a very interesting point, whether or not the application should have straight away be dismissed on this point or not. Okay, so after discussing everything, Supreme Court allowed the SLP, which was filed under which was filed for formation of arbitration tribunal in by invoking Section 11 of ANC Act, and Supreme Court also rightly concurred with the decision of adjudicating authority in dismissing Section 7 application, because they did not find any merit in Section 7 application filed by financial creditor. Hence, this matter was laid to rest by Supreme Court. Okay, so I hope I have been able to give some digest or very in summary form some detail about this Supreme Court judgment. I hope you would have liked my deliberation on this. Thank you so much.